My name is Nancy Hom, and I am an artist, a poet, curator, community organizer, and installation artist, I should say. I was born in China, in Taoyuan, China. I grew up in New York City, and I came to the Bay Area in 1974 with my husband, Bob Hsiang. It was difficult for an Asian American or Chinese American of my background to even aspire to be an artist. I was not encouraged to do anything in art growing up. My parents had no crayons in the house. They thought it was a frivolous occupation. And so I had to overcome that struggle in the beginning. Luckily, thanks to a few elementary school teachers, they encouraged me to go on in the arts. So much so that I wanted to go to an art school, Pratt Institute. I was approached during my last year at Pratt by Joanne Miyamoto, who is now known as Nobuko Miyamoto, and Chrissy Jima. And the two of them pulled me into the Asian American movement that was just forming at that time. I think that was the biggest shift in my career because I didn't know what I was gonna do when I graduated, but they introduced me to a whole world of activism. It was my choice to be a community artist, which meant that I worked for nonprofits and there was no money really in the arts. But I wanted to do something that I believed in, so I kept struggling through it. The first thing I worked on was a mural, because it just seemed so exciting to me. In the 70s, there were very few murals being done, so I wanted to see what was happening at this place called Kearney Street Workshop. And a friend took me there, and it was huge. There was a mural being planned a block long against the wall of the International Hotel. But I wasn't really sure what I was gonna do with my art. Then one day I embraced the silkscreen medium. But I was curious about this new medium, and in those days we didn't really have jobs like somebody hired me to do this. It was kind of you're having a poetry reading? You want a poster? You know, so I approached Al Robles and George Leong, Jessica Hagedorn, and a friend of mine helped me silkscreen it, because my first attempt at silkscreening, I would silkscreen one and admire it for a while, and then silkscreen another and admire it. And finally, I think it was Paul Kagawa, he said, "Give me that." And he just went, and I learned about the particulars of silkscreening. So you could say I learned as I went. Because of that, my friend Adela Chu, who started the first carnival in San Francisco, she said, "I want 200 posters and 6 colors." And I said, "I just learned how to silkscreen, and I only silkscreened one." But she said, "Sure, you can do it." And so we did. I silkscreened this at Kearney Street Workshop in a tiny little storefront that we occupied after we were evicted from the International Hotel. This was the first poster I did at Mission Graphica. I begged to join that group because I learned that they had acquired a silkscreen machine. And before that, I was silkscreening everything by hand and pulling the squeegee myself. But I begged Josh Sanchez and Rene Castro to let me in. They were silkscreening all the time, and they were doing stuff for the community or a lot of political causes. And I learned a lot about how to use the machine wisely, and also it gave me the freedom to create different techniques. I started doing mandalas in the year 2012, shortly after I did my first sculpture. This one I did on Japantown. It was commissioned by First Voice, and I was asked to do a 10-foot mandala on the floor that would kind of tell the history of Japantown, which in San Francisco is in danger of being destroyed, basically. So in it, I was able to tell 100 years of history and also involve different community members. And when they saw the thing, 10 feet of it, it was so astonishing to them, because all they knew was that they were creating a little 4x6 piece, but they didn't know how it would fit into the whole thing. And that's the magic of this community-based mandala work, is that you can see very physically that you are connected to everybody else. And it doesn't matter what you do. In fact, one of the preschoolers, she pasted the skirt on the face, and I put it in there anyway, because I promised that everybody would be in there. And it doesn't matter, because it's perfect as it is. It is an expression of a community as it is. This is what they came up with. So I'm excited that to see what everybody comes up with too. That confluence of, you know, three-dimensional claiming of space, and also my Buddhist training, somehow it results in a sculpture or a mandala or something else besides the two-dimensional art that I was doing. It felt like suddenly I didn't want to just be on the wall. I wanted to be three-dimensional. You know that big round circle as you come in to the school? Well, I do something like that. That has been my major art form for the last 7 years, and I've come full circle with this upcoming mandala, which starts with my San Francisco mandala that was done in 2015, and it will morph at the end of the show into a brand new mandala, and it will address San Francisco as it is today. It's wonderful to see everybody so engaged and working on projects intently, and they don't even know what the finished product will look like, but we'll be sure to show them. I keep coming to this, that if you're staying open, then you're staying open as the world comes and what the world gives you. So, you know, sheet metal, fine. But I didn't know that that was gonna be my medium. It's just like, wow, I see this thing and it wants to be sheet metal. And we let the medium, or we let the art piece, even as it's being born, we let it tell us what it wants to be.